gout in my left leg, swollen, infected. It changed my perspective from the time that you breastfed till you lying on your deathbed. Gotta keep the best head. Sometime a good thing comes in a hard package. Every fork in the road is a right.
Now, can children eat raw? Of course. And I've seen examples of children being raised on a raw food diet, and these become like superhumans. The things that they can do, because there's very little waste in their body. There's very little toxins. So, you know, mentally, physically, spiritually, they're just on another level.
Okay, so I just want to make sure for the audience, when the baby's in the womb, that's when you kind of go with your natural instinct or a natural craving for whatever you have, because that baby needs...
There's a lot of factors. Mm-hmm. So for the women, the first thing I would say is, okay, what is her diet? What has been her diet for the last 5 years? Or what has been the diet for her entire life?
Right.
Because if she has eaten the standard American diet, even if she's been vegan for, like, let's say a year or two or three, that's not long enough. That's not long enough. Maybe if it's been at least 10 years or more, mm-hmm. then I could say, okay, she can probably have a successful pregnancy and childbirth and healthy child. By being vegan for that long. The body, we are what we eat. And the body is constantly remaking itself. But like I said, it even goes back beyond us. It goes to our mother's mother's mother. And what they were eating.
Right.
See, we're all made up of all of that. So we have to consider that. We can't just ignore that. But if a woman has been... vegan for a year, you know, or vegan curious, and she's having cravings, she needs to follow those cravings, period. And, you know, when she has a child and then when she's breastfeeding, she needs to continue to follow those cravings. But then, you know, once she's able to, you know, she's finished breastfeeding and then, you know, she wants to go back to the vegan way, then, you know, she can follow that and raise her child, you know, vegan and, you know, have a healthy, you know, child and family.
Sexy, intelligence is sexy, 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 intelligence is sexy, sexy, sexy.
Paradise. I love her healthy lifestyle.
And how does paradise health and fasting and feasting... Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so with Paradise Health, basically it is a system of eating and not eating, essentially. And once you understand the power of not eating or fasting, and the importance, because you know, the power and the importance of it is really understanding that we should not eat food every day. That's number one. And because we shouldn't eat food every day, that allows different healing to happen. There's only one healer. And there's only one way to truly be healed, and that's through fasting. Herbs, traditional or herbal medicines, remedies, these things are all secondary to health and healing. Obviously, food is our medicine and medicine is our food. But the true medicine is not eating. Every time we eat anything, the body holds on to some of it. It stores it somewhere in the body. Okay, usually in a form of fat. Okay, so because if we're really living with nature, the body or nature will allow it for us to go through fasting periods, through if you want to use the word famine. And the thing is because this is a nature and this is a natural process, the body has already had its protective design where, again, everything you eat, any and everything you eat is going to store something. So that storage, when there is no food, now the body has something to tap into.
So how often should one eat?
I'm going to get to that.
Okay.
I just wanted to explain that because again, we should understand that we overeat, number one. And number two, you know, eating becomes, it becomes not about nourishment for most, if not all of us. It really becomes about entertainment. We don't eat to truly nourish ourselves. We're eating to entertain ourselves. And so what happens is when we start to fast. Now, when people come to me, they ask me all the time, oh, how long should I fast? And I say, and I always say, even if it's their first time, you should consider doing longer than 3 days. And by fast, I'm not just, because there's obviously different types of fast. You can fast on water, you can fast on fresh juice, you can even fast on fresh fruit. So regardless of what you're doing, obviously, you know, fasting on water and fasting on fruit is going to be different. But it's going to be more similar than different. But I always say fast more than 3 days because it takes about 3 to 4 days to tap into that storage. And when you tap into that storage that I spoke about, that's where a switch happens, where you're not hungry. Your energy goes up. And you feel this high, what I call a faster's high, where it's like you're not hungry, you have more energy than you ever had in your life, and you feel a sense of peace, just a serenity. That's what paradise health is all about. And you feel this high, what I call a faster's high, where it's like you're not hungry, you have more energy than you ever had in your life, and you feel a sense of peace, just a serenity. That's what paradise health is all about. Just really tapping into that zone and going to this level where, wow, like, I don't have to eat food every day. And so when you go to that point, now the body starts to use what it has stored as its fuel, which is what it's designed to do. Now, when it starts to do that, obviously, it doesn't have an infinite amount of that storage stored up. Even if we've been eating every day for all of our lives and we're 30, 40, 50 years old, okay, there's not an infinite storage. So ideally, the ideal fast is always going to be after the 3 day period, because that's almost like because those 3 days are going to be tough. All right, it's going to be difficult, like, because you're breaking, like, almost like you're breaking a habit. But by that fourth day, you're like, okay. And really, ideally, you're not supposed to eat until you feel hunger. And for a lot of people, that could be a few weeks, all right, until that hunger comes back, because that's when you've used up all the storage.
Now, just for the audience, that transition that you're talking about, now, what's the term for that? Like, if they look that up online, because I've heard people talk about getting into that stage where, hey, I'm transitioning, and now I get this boost of energy.
Oh, so, some people call it ketosis.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
So if they look online, they'll say, oh, okay, that's what ketosis.
Yeah. But I'm not a big fan of the keto diet and the whole ketosis. But, you know, that's another, I guess we can address that later. But yeah, Paradise Health is really about tapping into that, using those stores. Because what ends up happening, or what can happen, is if we never tap into that, that can turn on us. If we never utilize those storages, those things, especially where we're most susceptible, we're most weak, that can become ultimately cancer. Tumors can form, issues can crop up. Wherever the body will find is weak, and this is the body again trying to preserve itself. But again, we never tap into that, and because we never tap into that, then that's what can take place.
Okay, so now I will go back again. My week, if I'm looking at a diet during the week, what would be, and just in your opinion, what would be the ideal? How often should one eat during, you know, weekly?
Now we talked about like fasting and like with that first example where, you know, again, it can be a few weeks. At least you want to go beyond those 3 days. Now, it really depends. Now, you want to find a rhythm. Now, what I recommend is you do the type of fast that I spoke of, where you fast until your true hunger comes back, which is always going to be after that third, fourth, fifth day. It could be at the 10th day, but normally, especially if someone has a considerable amount of storage, it's going to be a few weeks. So what I recommend is like each and every one of us do something like that once a year, at least once a year, where we fast for at least 2 to 3 weeks, and that be a annual yearly ritual. Whatever time that year is for you. Like for me, it's every December. So I don't necessarily set a day. But every December, definitely into the first week, I'll start to lose my appetite. Food won't taste the same. And again, these are some of the signs that, okay, the body is ready to go into fast. When it almost becomes a chore to eat. These are like the things I start to feel every December, like clockwork. And I'll fast at least 10 to 14 days every December. Okay. Now that's once a year. Okay. Now, there's obviously a lot of intervals. Now we have to start to look at all of the cycles within our lives. Probably the most significant cycle is a daily cycle. You know, the sun comes up, the sun comes down. We have, you know, depending on the season, you know, I mean, typically we'll have, you know, a certain amount of time of sunlight, some amount of time of darkness. And we fast every night, actually, when we go to sleep. But really, beyond a 24-hour cycle is what we have to look at. So the next major cycle, because within the 24-hour period, that's what we start talking about. Really intermittent fasting, or fasting within the day period. I don't really consider that a true fast, because I feel like you should go to sleep at least twice before eating. That being the true fast. Like you go to sleep tonight, you go through the whole day, and you go to sleep again.
Right.
Like if you eat...
No counting hours.
Right,
no
right. Counting hours. We're not saying, oh, we're doing 22 hours. That ain't no real fast to me.
Okay.
Right. No 23 hours, like 32 minutes.
I'm guilty. Okay.
Right. That ain't no true fast. No, you got to go to sleep twice.
Okay.
Okay? So that being a true fact. So we're not going to go into the whole intermittent. Even though eating once a day, which again, just because you didn't eat breakfast don't mean that you I don't consider that a true fast, or you didn't eat breakfast and lunch. Even though that's, you know, we could talk about that. But as far as like our next major cycle, which is a week, I find that doing a, at least what I call, not a 36-hour, but a 48-hour fast with every week, and a 48-hour, or I should say 47-hour, because 47-hour, so basically, I'll use me as an example. So every week, my last meal of the week is Saturday. And not because it's the last day of the week, but that's my last meal until Monday. Hmm. And so I'll have, let's say I have my meal at 5 p.m. Saturday. I won't have my next meal until 5 p.m. Monday. That's 48 hours. So it is, yes, 48 hours, not 47. 48 hours. That is like that's my, and that's become, again, my natural rhythm, my natural cycle. Like, you know, we do things in our culture, we do things, you know, just at, on a personal family level, that are weekly rituals. And one of the best things we can do is give at least one day out of the week where we give our digestive organs a well-deserved rest. Because that, again, like I said, fasting is the only healing. It is the only one and true best healer, is fasting. So the weekly cycle, one day a week. The next major cycle is our moon cycle, or our month cycle. And this is where I key in on the feminine, the woman. All women have a natural moon cycle. So I feel like the moon and fasting with the moon is more affiliated or more significant for the females, where the next major cycle is our sun cycle, where the sun will go through a transition every 3 months. And that's where I feel as men, we, those periods become more significant for us. So fasting with the equinoxes and the solstices. Women fasting every lunar period, whether it's with their lunar or their new moon, like with their, you know, during their period. And I have a video on this on my YouTube channel where I talk about why women should fast with the moon, whether it be the actual moon and that actual cycle, where they fast with the new moon, full moon, or their own moon cycle. And, you know, men fasting with the sun.
Really quickly, your YouTube channel, if they want to tune into your YouTube channel, what's your heading? What's
Khepra, youtube.com/ Khepra, K-H-E-P-R-A.
Eternal dance, a strong spirit, a free thought, a open mind, a loving heart.
Approach we do others. It for the 3 weeks. Yeah, times we do it weekly.
Yeah, I recommend the best ultimate fast in terms of ingesting anything by far is the coconut water. And that's truly why I call, I mean, that's another, you know, angle to the paradise health. Because in a paradise setting, probably the one food you're definitely going to find is coconuts. And in my book, I really go into the power of the coconut water. And when you use the coconut water, and that's what really, you know, being into raw foods, initially, in fasting, And when I was fasting, I was fasting primarily with water. I was using different types of water fast. I would do a distilled water versus spring water. And I was doing fresh juices. And I became discouraged with fasting because I would fast. Let's say I would fast for 7 days. And then when I break the next 7 days, I would basically eat double. And I was like, okay, something is off here. Because I knew that that was any benefit that I got from the fast, I was almost damaging myself because it was almost like I couldn't help myself. I had to eat twice as much, almost to make up for the time that I didn't eat. It wasn't until I got introduced to fasting with coconut water where I did not feel hungry. I felt more complete. And when I broke the fast, I didn't feel like I had to eat for the days that I did not eat.
Right.
And because this was such a paradigm shifting experience for me, I decided to just research it more. I wrote about it, and that's truly what Paradise Health, fasting with coconut water. So my fast that I use for my clientele, all of the juices have coconut water. Hmm. So whether it be a fruit juice, a green juice, it has coconut water in there. And, you know, coconut water is not only the best water, it is the only water that I consider a whole food. So meaning, like, the coconut water can flush the colon. Like, no colonic, no enema needed. No herbs needed. Flush the colon and all the internal organs. So you're getting whole food nutrition as a water. So not only using it as the foundation for fast, but foundation for food. I mean, as a chef, using coconut water for everything. Anything that water, you know, if I'm making a dressing, if I'm making a soup, if I'm just need a little water for this, that, and the third, I'm using coconut water. Coconut water is, in my opinion, in my view, in my research, the number one food, the number one most important food on the planet. Complete, both a fruit and a nut, and a seed, simultaneously. So, yes, power of coconuts, coconut water is big. Now, that is, if you're fasting just on coconut water, that's going to be the ultimate, complete, ideal. Better than distilled water, better than breath, like doing a breath fast, definitely better than fruit juices or green juices. Because again, you know, when we look at fruit, or, you know, whether you're juicing fruits or vegetables, you're drinking a processed food. You have to process that. You're removing the juice from the fiber. See, with coconut water, you know, it's complete. It's a whole food water. It's a whole food and a water. You drink water. Any other kind of water is going to be second to coconut water. And again, coconut water being complete, electrolytes, basically electricity. And so it's going to, because it's bringing that electricity, it's bringing that added healing. So coconut water is the ideal. Now, second is your fresh juices, even above water. Because, again, for most of us, you know, what we get from fresh juices is we're getting vitamins, we're getting antioxidants, and the juice is, I like to look at it as a natural detergent. for the body. So it's almost like if you're just using water, like if you were trying to wash your dishes, for example, with just water. Now with hot water, you'd be able to do some work. But, you know, just a little detergent will go a long way with that water. And that's how I look at the juice. The juice is going to go. So it's almost like, because the thing with fasting, the body will detox at a level depending on the level of work or, you know, and the work is directly related to the amount of nutrition we put in. So if we're eating obviously very nourishing, dense food like fats and proteins, our body's not going to detox at all. Versus if we eat a lot of fruit, which has a lot of water and doesn't have a lot of fat and protein. Fruit, that's why I said, if you eat a lot of fruit, food is going to detox you. Okay, so that's like kind of like the trade-off. Versus drinking juice, again, it's going to be like almost like coconut water if you're drinking fresh juices. So it's going to be a second to coconut water, a close second, or maybe even a distant second. So coconut water, or if you're just doing both, you're right there. And you're going to get the ultimate benefit of really, you know, achieving that state of paradise health. Because you're using really the top food as not only a fuel, but as a way to really allow it to go into the body, and allowing the body to again go at those storages, but then giving it what it needs to do anything that you want to do, you know. So, you know, because the thing is like, you know, just because you're fasting doesn't mean that life has to stop. You know, so it doesn't mean, you know, you can, you know, go to work. You can do all the things that you used to doing or you normally do and allow your body to heal.
So how concerned should I be with the sugar when I'm fasting? The sugar that comes from the juices or maybe my potassium going up from the coconut water. How concerned should I be about that? Well,
the potassium going up should be a good thing. You know, potassium is, again, electricity. You know, it's a very powerful electrolyte. It is a relaxant. It is a thing, and this is why they say, you know, you drink your coconut water and it wash your heart. It literally is washing your heart. So we should not be concerned with these metrics per se. Now, if you know, I always ask, you know, my clients, you know, especially if they're looking to, like, say, somebody's dealing with cancer or some kind of advanced illness, how do you feel? Now, if something feels off, then we have to look at it further. You go get your test and see what is confirming your feeling. But if you're feeling better than you felt, there's no reason to, because what can happen is a doctor can conduct a test and say, oh, you know, this, your potassium level is too high. And that can, you know, be, again, because there's a trust built in there and not on their own feeling, their own body being their own doctor, they can trust that over the confirmation that they've already received and totally discard and go away from it, what is really truly healing them. So as far as the sugars, the same thing. Again, we need sugar ultimately. And the sugar coming from fresh juices and coconut water is balanced with the moisture content. You know, the sugar that is most dangerous is sugar that is coming from things that are high in sugar with no water, like starch. That's where the sugar becomes very, very dangerous.
Processed, you know, sugar.
Right, because it's condensed. And it's processed, it's cooked. It's a drug at that point.
Right.
You know, but our natural sugars get demonized, unfairly so. Mm-hmm. You know, that are coming with enzymes and fruits and antioxidants and phytonutrients and all different things that we need.
So is there a... Just on sugar really quickly, is there a sugar, I mean, outside of the raw sugars, is there a sugar that you would say, hey, if you have to have sugar, this is the sugar you should go with? Like, you know, you have the cane sugar that you have. Mm. So is it anything outside of raw? I know it's hard for you. I mean.
No, I mean, you know, when I make a food, I use agave. You know, I'm not against honey, you know, the raw honey. I mean, between the agave, the honey, dates, you can use dates. That's about it. I mean, because, you know, at the end of the day, a sugar is a sugar. You know, or at least a sweetener is a sweetener. I should say it like that. Because everything is sugar.
Right.
But every sugar ain't sweet. So we have to understand, like, when we say sugar. That's why I say sugars are... We need sugar. You know? And somebody say they not eating sugar, they're lying to you. Because everything breaks down to a sugar.
Right.
So sugar is not the enemy. Okay? Yes, now eating sweet foods all the time, that's not good. We need a balance of different taste. We need sweet, we need bitter, we need sour, we need hot. We need all these different varying tastes because they all have different nutritional components which lead to a balanced diet.
Coffee causes high cholesterol and makes you fidget. Healthy food is costly, but being sick is more expensive.
Okay, Khepra, I'm doing my raw food diet. It's December. It's cold outside. This is not the ideal weather. I don't know what to do because I can't get to the right stuff and I'm hungry. So, how would you advise a person to handle the raw food diet during the winter?
Yeah, I think in the wintertime, because, you know, I mentioned how not only do I, for me in December is actually when I lose my appetite.
Right.
So it's not even, I'm not even trying to go to a stronger form of food. I'm going to no food. So, and I've done this every December for years. So it's almost not, I mean, I know I'm only one person, but that's almost to me, an excuse. I don't think it really holds any kind of real weight other than your own ritual, annual nostalgia. You know, yes, there is something to be said about cold weather and you wanting, you know, just a desire for something different. But it doesn't mean, because the thing is like, if you eat cooked food during the winter, it's really only going to make you colder.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really only going to make you colder. The thing is yes, raw food, and still, raw food can, you know, because there's a coolness to raw food. And one of the things that I do, what becomes a daily ritual for me is a hot bath. And that may sound like something that's totally like, okay, what does that have to do with food? Well, a hot bath, especially in the morning, will get a circulation. Well, it's almost like I'm Because what is a hot bath? A hot bath is water that's been sitting on fire. So it's not really almost about the water, it's about the fire. So yeah, cooked food is the same thing. We're trying to eat fire. Okay? So while there is something to that, because if we were in a tropical region, yeah, we would be getting the fire just by going outside. Okay, so for me, that's one of the things that I've done is I go towards the hot bath. Another thing is eating foods that have heat naturally. Okay, peppers, your hot peppers, things like onion, garlic, that whole family, which is like the mustard family, you know, onion, garlic, there's shallots, there's scallion or green onions, leeks, etc. And ginseng. Ginseng is another hot root where it's not spicy like ginger, but it produces heat in the body. Well, the red ginseng, at least. So these are some foods, again, that'll, you know, produce some heat in the body. But it's really about the fire. And so for me, like I said, the hot bath, it really works. It really almost gives me that charge, because again, when I sit in a warm, and again, I didn't say hot shower, I said hot bath. It's something different about submerging your body within a tub of water versus just letting hot water hit you. Because that's going to, I feel, bring about a circulation within the blood, in the body, in a certain way, that's going to be more beneficial. It's going to allow you to, well, it's going to stimulate the body in a way. So just those are just some of those tips. But I feel like, even in the wintertime, I mean, we're spending most of our time indoors with 70, 80 degree temperatures. So, again, I think it becomes more about the ritual and the nostalgia of the year end, especially with the holidays. And, you know, people just, it's almost psychological.
Football game.
Right, you know. It's more about entertainment.
Every day bring challenge, every challenge is a chance to advance. The power is right in our own hands. From a youth full of rage to a wise grown man. Here I am.
So, all right, talk to me a little bit about the importance of food combinations. Is it, you know, some vegans and raw vegans, they say, hey, you shouldn't mix these two things together, or this or that. So, in your opinion, what's the importance of food combinations?
Well, there's only one improper food combination, and that is, I actually mentioned it. I mentioned it earlier in our conversation. And that's fat or protein. And I say fat or protein because usually fat and protein are together with starch. And ironically enough, that is the combination that we all love. And most popular foods, there's always usually a fat starch or protein starch combination. So we look at things like hamburger, pizza, I'm sure you can come up with a lot of examples where there's a certain dish that has a fat and a protein, fat protein with starch combination. Now, why is it bad? Well, starch being essentially a sugar, a form of sugar, and the enzyme that is responsible for breaking down the starch is found in the mouth, where the enzyme for breaking down the fat and protein are in the stomach or in the gut. And what ends up happening is the body can't simultaneously break them down efficiently, especially when cooked. So what ends up happening is you can get fermentation that takes place with the starch. And what happens is alcohol can happen as a result, in terms of it being able, the body breaking it down. And, you know, if you're eating a lot of, again, like starchy products, and you're not going to eat like bread, most of the time people are not just going to eat bread. Or somebody not going to eat a baked potato. They're going to eat a french fry, though. It's french fry been boiled in oil. Okay, so you see how these things start to, you know, how these things are connected. And what ends up happening is, and this is the reason why starches are the most addictive foods, is because when they ferment and break down, they break down into alcohol, and it's almost like that starch, you become almost like a alcoholic, you know, starchaholic, but it's really the alcohol. And that feeling that you get from eating starch becomes very, very addictive. So that is really the one and only improper food combination. Now, there are other combinations, minor combinations, like certain fruit, don't mix this fruit with this fruit, but these things are minor and pale compared to that starch protein, because we all want to eat that. Now, with the raw cuisine, now, again, that's almost like the exception, because, you know, we're combining fat and protein with starches, with raw food starches, is all the difference. Like, for example, you know, I do a raw food lasagna. What is the starch in a raw food lasagna? It's fresh zucchini. And what's amazing with the lasagna, it's like once you layer the lasagna and you allow it to sit and come together, that zucchini becomes almost, there's so much water released. Okay, so yes, zucchini is a starch, but it's a starch that has a lot of water. Okay, so now I'm combining, you know, because I'm, you know, I'm putting in different other elements into it that form the protein and form the fat, like the cheese, the raw vegan cheese, and some other elements to it that is going to give it, whether it's the taste or the protein or the filler. But again, it's like with the raw cuisine, it's almost safe to combine the fat and protein. Okay. The fat and protein with the starch.
Stay on purpose, maintain balance. Nobody perfect, the path is the practice. Good habits, zen focus, remain
now,
present in each moment.
About a year or two into my raw food is when I met my eventual teacher, Dr. Aris Latham, who I'm sure you're referring to, you know, originally from Panama, studied here in the US, been all over the world, really is the creator of the modern raw food cuisine. Yes.
Okay. That's him. Okay. Yeah.
He is credited with creating the modern raw food cuisine. And, you know, I'm just really blessed and honored to really be probably his, I mean, he has thousands of students, but I can honestly say that I'm probably his foremost student that has really taken this lifestyle in terms of, you know, doing the work. So I think I can get away with saying that. And not because I'm trying to, you know, brag or boast or anything. I just feel like for me it's an honor. And I feel an immense responsibility, you know, to carry on, to be a torchbearer, so to speak. And while he's still living, there are times we still work together, and I still learn, you know, because he's already been where I'm at.
In a war for help, a lifelong mission. I see the victory. Discipline will conquer addiction. It don't matter if the dope is from the street or prescription.
I want to ask you about alkaline versus acidic, and the importance of balance in this whole raw food, in this raw food deal.
Yeah, well, you know, it's like you said, it's really about balance. You know, alkalinity is an extreme, just like acidity is an extreme. Now, if someone was to ask me, you know, should we be alkaline versus acidic? We definitely should be more alkaline, but not much more. You know, you can do a urine test or you can do a blood test, and your urine or your blood should be a little above 7. You don't want it to necessarily be much more than that. Now, because that is, when you look at the acid alkaline scale, that is, again, a balance. That is about being, because there are certain alkaline foods that are obviously very beneficial, and there are certain acidic foods. Acidic foods tend to be more grounding. Alkaline foods tend to be, they tend to have different mineral complexes. And we really need a little bit of both. Okay. Alkaline foods tend to be mucus dissolving. Acidic foods tend to be mucus forming. Again, a little mucus is okay and sometimes even necessary. But again, it's about the balance. Which really, you know, anytime I think about the acid alkaline balance, I always like to mention, you know, marijuana smoking, because marijuana, as we know, is a very strong alkaline plant. And when smoked, it produces a strong alkaline, almost a too strong alkaline response, which leads to the high that everyone, the reason why anyone, I think, well, people, you know, smoke it on a recreational level. But that alkalinity is too much, which again produces what we know as what? The munchies, the craving. The munchies is nothing but an acidic craving. Because again, the body wants balance. It doesn't necessarily want to be that so alkaline, especially with producing the alkalinity come as a result of putting the plant under fire. Okay. Or at least that THC chemical in the plant under fire. Because what you're doing is you're it's like you're putting it on an extreme level, on a, you know, that fire, you know, you're taking it to the extreme. And so those munchies are going to come because again, the body is seeking balance. And so, yeah, so it's really just about balance and, you know, being frugivores, fruit eaters. When we look at the nutrition, when we look at the acid alkaline balance of most of your fruits, they're right. Most of them are right in the middle.
Okay, do you have a message for anyone that's thinking about taking on a raw vegan diet?
Yeah, that's a great question, because I mean, the first thing I would think is, you know, this is not for the masses. And, you know, one of the things, I mean, I got a couple of things that I want to say about that, because it's not for the masses. The main thing, other than the nutritional aspect, is the social aspect. So that's one of the components. You know, I have a talk where I talk about, you know, becoming and staying raw, because I've seen people do it, and you know. And I talk, and I say, you know, food, you know, our relationship with food is just like any other relationship. You know, some relationships are for a reason, a season, or a lifetime. And so that's one of the first things you gotta think about is like, okay, is this going to be for a season? And for a lot of people, it's just a season, or maybe a date or two. It's like, I can go out on a date with you, but I don't have to marry you. You know, that's a major commitment. That's a major, you know, and food is everything. Food is our culture. Food is our everything about our life. You know, anything we do, social, whether it be happy or sad, it's going to be about food. Where we work, that's going to determine the type of food we eat. And definitely where we play and how we socialize and your partner. That's all, these things are going to determine the food that you eat. Facts. So these things got to be thought out. You know, is it going to be for a reason, a season, or a lifetime? Number one. Number two. Obviously, this is, you know, one of the best reasons to do it is for health. Now, for me, I wasn't sick. I wasn't, you know, facing a life-threatening disease or anything like that. I wanted my desire to do it was to see what my highest potential could be. You know, that's what motivated me, and it still motivates me. You know, what, like, how healthy can I be? You know, and I think for each of us, we have to determine, you know, especially if we're into, you know, life-giving practices like fitness or yoga or meditation, or, you know, any of the movement arts. Again, you know, a lot of us are into these things for different reasons. And we're motivated by, you know, it could be something really simple. And that could be enough. So, again, it's really about tapping into that and really, really being steadfast. Because again, that social piece is going to be major. So most of it, you know, health, you know, because there's detox, there's there's education. You know, education is a major component. We have to continue to educate. There's a lot of information out there. And one thing I found, especially about different diets, anyone can argue and make that argument the best sounding argument for any diet out there, even a standard American diet. That is our blessing and our curse, is that we can use logic, we can use the power of presenting information in such a way that it can be convincing no matter what it is. And so, with that being said, there's going to be a lot of information out there for everything. So, you know, you just have to continue. If this is the direction that you want to go, why are you going to do it? And basically find the things that are going to support that mentally. Because education is really that, just that mental food that we get. I mentioned the social piece, which can't be understated. The education piece, the social piece, there's the health piece. And then, last but not least, is the chef piece. You gotta, you know, again, there's nothing convenient about this lifestyle, you know, and that's what got me into this, is like, at least from a chef perspective, is that I mean, there's no restaurants that I can go to, there's no carryouts, like, I had to go to the store and make my own food, and, you know, and here I am today, so... So, you know, these are the things you got to think about, and the last thing I'll say is, you know, typically if you want to do a raw food challenge, I say go for 100 days. You know, 100 days is a season, it's more than a season, because it's longer than 3 months. And there's something about the number 100. You know, it's almost a third of a year. And so if you can do 100 days, you can do 200 days. If you do 200 days, you can do a year. If you do a year, you can do a lifetime. So, you know, you start with 100 days. It's enough time where it's like, okay, I think that's a long enough date. Where it's like, okay, do I want to commit to death do us apart, or do I want to do something else? Or do I want to just, you know, see you on the weekends kind of thing? You know, so again, you know, I think, you know, just looking at it in all those different facets, you can make the best decision for you. Because while I say raw food diet is probably the healthiest diet, it's not necessarily the best diet. It's the best diet for me, but like I said, food is culture, tradition, religion. It's your life. And, you know, all of us are going to be here for the time that we're going to be here. And, you know, if you decide to go on this path, then I congratulate you. I welcome you to the family.
What role would you say spirituality plays in this? And you know, in your meditation and stuff like that, what role does that play?
Well, anytime we talk about spirituality, one of the words or one of the things that I think about in terms of you know, when we talk spirituality, you know, we think about like certain spiritual laws. It's the law of karma. Okay, And karmically, this is the highest vibrational diet. Because not only, you know, what's karma? What you do, you have done unto you. So, I mean, the highest thing is our food. You know, it's like if you know, if we love our food, if we don't heat it, we don't kill it, and especially vegan, then it's like we're vibrating on a high level spiritually. So we think about karma. I mean, we can only think about, at least the highest karmic diet is definitely the vegan diet. Now, the other thing that really, you know, when we think about spirituality, we got to think about the breath, you know, because, you know, with spirituality and meditation, we talk about breathing, we talk about, you know, just being fluid. So, you know, in that sense, we think about water. So not only are we eating a high water diet, again, that is, you know, we're eating food that has living enzymes, living essence. So that's putting us in a living essence kind of state. You know, it's raising our vitality, it's raising our spirituality just by the nature of the food that we're eating. You know, so, you know, spirituality, meditation, high karma vibes, vibrations, you know.
When troubles sleep, young Gago will come. Waiting in the fight.
Palava in the fight.
Palava, he go get you.
Palava, he go get.
Palava. When cat sleep, rat go bite him tail. Waiting in the fight.
Palava in the fight.
Palava, he go get you. Oh, oh, oh. Janet lost him job. Him sit down for house. Him dey think of chop. Mr. Landlord come wake him up. He say, Mr. pay me your rent. Waiting he dey find.
Palava he dey find.
Palava he go get you.
Palava,
he could get you. My friend just come from prison.